In this video, we'll discuss about canine space. Canine space is one of the primary space of maxilla, that is primarily involved in direct spread of infection from the canine tool. Okay, first we'll see boundaries, after that source of infection and clinical features and management. Okay, so you can see in this diagram the boundaries. When the infection from the canine perforates labial cortex of the maxilla above the levator anguli oris muscle. Okay, this is the levator anguli oris, this blue color one, and this is the levator labii superioris. This is levator labii superioris alequanesi, and this is zygomaticus minor, and this is zygomaticus major muscles. Okay, so first we have inferior boundary, that is levator anguli oris. When the perforation is above this muscle attachment, that is levator anguli oris, then the involvement of canine space occurs. Okay, this levator anguli oris muscles originate just inferior to the infraorbital foramen. This is the infraorbital foramen. So inferiorly we have levator anguli oris and superiorly we have levator labii superioris. So accordingly, the canine space boundary inferiorly is levator anguli oris and superiorly is levator labii superioris. And medially we have levator labii superioris alequanesi. And laterally we have zygomaticus minor and major muscles. Right? And deep aspect is anterior surface of the maxilla. That is surface of maxilla facing towards us. And superficially, that is above these things, we have levator labii superioris and skin of the cheek. That means this levator labii superioris runs downwards and it inserts on the upper lip. So superficially we have levator labii superioris and skin. So these are the boundaries of the canine space. If you remember this diagram, you can write. And after that, source of infection. The main source of infection is the long rooted canine tooth. Okay, when the root of the canine tooth is long enough to pass the muscle attachment, that is levator anguli oris muscle attachment, it will involve in canine space infection. And in some cases, if the root of the first premolar is above this muscle, then there is also chances of involving canine space. That means there are two sources of infection, that is main one is the canine and the second one is first premolar. And after that, clinical features. There are only four main clinical features you should write in the exam. The main foremost important thing is the obliteration of the nasolabial fold. This is the most important. You can see in this diagram, nasolabial fold is nothing but a fold on the lateral side of the nose. So that fold is obliterated and you can see the swelling in upper lip and cheek region. That means especially in the infraorbital region. Okay, so first one is obliteration of the nasolabial fold and cellulitis of eyelids. This is another most important features. Cellulitis especially involving lower eyelid. Mostly it will involve lower eyelid and it may involve upper eyelid also, resulting in the closure of eye. Okay, and after that, swelling of upper lip and infraorbital region and drooping of angle of mouth. One side of the angle of the mouth is drooped like that. That is no lowering of the angle of the mouth. So if you write these four clinical features, that is enough. First, you shouldn't miss obliteration of nasolabial fold and cellulitis of eyelids. And then coming to the management, if you left this canine space infection, then it will lead to the cavernous sinus thrombosis, most important complication of canine space infection, because infection from canine space can travel through the facial vein and then through the inferior ophthalmic vein and superior ophthalmic vein, and then it may involve cavernous sinus. So most important complication is cavernous sinus thrombosis. Okay, under management, you have to do the general management, that is you have to prescribe antibiotics, analgesics. Okay, and if the patient is dehydrated, and then you have to give the hydration therapy also. When there is well localized abscess, then you have to go for incision and drainage. This incision and drainage can be done intraorally or extraorally. That is, extraoral is nothing but percutaneous approach, but the intraoral is the most recommended method. So you can see in this is the maxillary, labial and buccal vestibules. So you have to take a incision high in the maxillary vestibule in the region of lateral incisor or canine. That means like this you have to take an incision and you have to bluntly open the abscess cavity to drain the pus. Okay, so intraoral approach provides you dependent approach. In the case of percutaneous approach, you can make a small incision at the medial corner of the eye here. Okay, you can make a small incision at the medial angle of the eye. By that approach you can drain the pus, but it doesn't provide the dependent way of abscess drainage. Okay, because abscess localization is somewhat inferior to this point, so there may be insufficient drainage of pus. So these are the two incision and drainage methods. Intraoral approach is the most commonly recommended method. Okay, because the swelling occurs in the medial angle of the eye. That means due to the space between the levator labii superioris and levator labii superioris alequanaceae, the gap between these two muscles allows the infection spread to the overlying skin. Okay, so you can do the incision at the medial angle of the eye also. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.